It's TV school time. WOI-TV, in association with Iowa State Teachers College, presents another program in the Iowa TV School Time series, Landmarks in Iowa History. Today's topic is Froelich. Your teachers are Herb Hake and Irma Plain of Iowa State Teachers College.
Hello, boys and girls. I just bought a whole sack full of things in this department store back here. Does that look like a department store to you? It is. That is one of the first department stores in the United States. Nowadays, we go to the big cities and we go to these skyscrapers and we go to all the departments where they have merchandise of many different kinds. And we think a department store is something very modern. And yet, many country towns had department stores many, many years ago. And here in Froelich is this department store, Burlingame's General Merchandise. And just to give you an idea of the variety of things you can get in a department store like this, let me show you what I bought. Here is a chain. I suppose this could be used for a calf. I'm going to use it for a dog. See, this has a snaffle hook on the end. You can put that on the dog's collar. And you can hold it with this. You can lead the dog around, and the dog can't get away. That's a good, strong chain. That's one of the things I got here in this general merchandise store. And I also got me a bottle of liniment. This is to ease the pain in my aching back. And I got some foam rubber insoles. You put these inside the shoes and that relieves the pain in your feet when you walk a great deal. Of course, you boys and girls don't have these pains in your feet. When you get older, like I am, you notice those things. And then I bought some stamps. I'm always running out of stamps. And I got some dye. I have some white shirts that I can't wear on television because you can't wear white. White is too much of a glare, you see. So I have to have my white shirts dyed to make them suitable for use on television. So I got this dye here in this store. And I bought my wife a box of stationery. Isn't that pretty? There. All these things you get here in this store. Here's something else I got for my wife. This is a scarf. Her name before she was married was McKinley, which is a Scotch name. And this is the McKinley plaid. See? Had quite a choice. And not to be outdone myself, I got myself a pair of socks. These may look large, but they'll be just right. Very attractive socks. Something else I got from my wife, a new scrub brush. And for my office, I got a roll of adding machine tape. And Dr. Plain is with me today, and we still have a long way to go back to Cedar Falls. So I bought a loaf of rye bread and a bologna. So if we get hungry on the way back to Cedar Falls, we'll have lunch. See, I already have a thermos full of coffee. But the bologna sandwiches on rye bread should be very, very tasty. Well, all these things, and there are many more things that I could have bought here, all of these things were purchased here in this store, here at Froelich. And this is one of the few remaining general stores that you can still find in Iowa. Let me show you some pictures on the inside of that store. It's a wonderful place to visit. And of course, our main reason for being here today is not to visit a store exactly, but since we are here, we might as well look at it. This is how the store looked about 60 years ago. Now, if you've noticed that building in the background, you'll see that it hasn't changed very much. This window has been boarded up, and there is a sign on the building now that says Burlingame Store, General Merchandise. But the porch is still pretty much the same. And Mr. Alonzo Burlingame and Mrs. Burlingame live upstairs here where they've lived for many years. This whole lower floor is the store. Here's one of these old-fashioned high-wheeled bicycles. Here are a couple of mules pulling a wagon. Some horses over here pulling another wagon. The horses are gone, but the mules too. But the store is still there. Notice this false front up here. Now compare that with this picture taken last summer. The building's been painted, but otherwise it's pretty much the same as it was in the old days. This tree has grown up. The horses and mules have disappeared. But the store itself is very much as it was in the old days. Now, take a look on the inside here. This is a wonderful place, and you could spend days in here and not see all of the stock. Back here is Mr. Burlingame. This is the post office back here. And there are a lot of boxes here for the people who get their mail here at this post office. That's where I bought my stamps. And notice all the things on the shelves. Here are milk pails, cream cans, boxes of spools, all sorts of drugs and sundries here. And Mr. Burlingame has kept some stamps up here that have been sold, different issues of stamps that have been sold throughout the years. Here are a lot of stuffed animals and fish, pictures, old guns. A wonderful place. Here is the dry goods section of the store. Here's where you buy all the scarves and mittens and socks and underwear and shirts and neckties, anything you can think of, yard goods. But it's next to the bread counter here, you see. In a general merchandise store, you don't go to a different floor to get to a different department. You just walk across the building. Just walk from one place to another on the same level. Here's the bread. Here's the feed section. Feed for cattle. Here are the dry goods back here. And back here is the sundries section again. A lot of drugs and things back here. Soft drinks. And here Mr. Burlingame is demonstrating an invention by John Froelich. John Froelich's father is the man who gave this village its name. And John Froelich the Younger, about whom we're going to talk today, invented this washing machine. This is the washboard principle, except that John Froelich put it on a cylinder, put the washboard on a cylinder, and you run the clothes right through it. From one side to the other, you see, and then back if they're not clean. And this proved to be a very popular invention. Still here in the store. But the most important invention of John Froelich was the gasoline tractor. And before Dr. Plain tells you about that, I think we ought to see exactly where Froelich is. This is Froelich, right up here. Froelich is a kind of a happy-sounding name for a town, isn't it? You know what Froelich means? Have you ever heard the German expression, Fröhlichen Weihnachten? That means a Merry Christmas, or a Happy Christmas. The word Froelich means happy. And I imagine the people who lived here years and years ago have many happy memories of their life in Froelich. There isn't much left here now except the store, but it has a very interesting history. Well, here is Froelich, not very far from McGregor. Here is Castalia, where Dr. Plain and I visited a sugar camp last fall. Here is Fort Atkinson. Here is Spillville. Here is Decorah. Here's Guttenberg. You see many interesting places right here in this northeast corner of Iowa. Here's Waterloo, and down here is Des Moines. Now, Dr. Plain, you remember the boys and girls, don't you? And I'm sure the boys and girls remember you. Will you tell the boys and girls about conditions of growth so far as farming is concerned in Iowa back in 1892 and how the tractor came to be invented here in Froelich?
I will give you the point. Mr. Haight, I think the boys and girls have heard their mothers and fathers and grandparents talk about the great amount of work that the pioneers had with all this grade A land that we have in Iowa. The work it was to turn the sod. Also, for example, when they used an object that you only think of as being in a museum, a cradle to harvest, from the hand labor to the horses was important. But The thing that we're observing here, especially at Froelich, was the switch eventually from horses to motors for movable power. And that, of course, practically revolutionized farming, say, clear across the United States, of course. It goes back to England for some of its beginnings. And I think to get you in the mood for this, you might, as you think of the environment we're in here, think in terms of maybe two dates, you Iowa history students. 1892, when a terrific racket must have taken place in this neighborhood, when a local blacksmith started a motor, and I'm going to let Mr. Haig tell you how that motor got started, and the rumble and the experiment here was something that would move. It went forward, it went backward, and then this contraption went down the road to a neighboring farm, and there they actually hitched it up to a thrashing machine, and some probably oats was thrashed with that. So that's what happened basically in 1892. Now that contraption that cluttered down this road that didn't look like the machine you would think of had a long way to go for refinement. And so you have to think also in terms of until almost the 1930s before this contraption would be in general use on Iowa's farms. Now I think since we're here at Froelich, we should first get acquainted with the gentleman who worked here at Froelich when there was much more than just a country store. Mr. Haig has indicated already that it was a very active and interested gentleman in this town, and you might first get acquainted, and as you look at him, I'm sure in his Sunday best clothes, think of him as a local blacksmith, a man who was born, I think it was 1845, and who died in 1933. He was born in the name of one of the Spanish land-grant towns, Gaillard. He soon came here to Froelich, and eventually he moved to Waterloo, and I think died in St. Paul. But we're more interested, I think, in this neighborhood of Froelich. And here we want to think in terms of this blacksmith. Mr. Haig told you about a washing machine. Mr. Froelich must have been very helpful for the local farmers, both what they had to do by hand and what horses could help them with, because he had, outside of his blacksmith shop, quite a few gadgets, I would gather. One, a well driller. Another one, I think he worked on a portable elevator, which should have been a big help when you think of all the hand shoveling and that type of thing of the crops. Furthermore, I think he had an early thrashing ring, which must have been a big relief. But from the steam engine invention, there was this pressure and this feeling if they could just get some of this power out into the fields where it would be movable, how helpful that would be. Now actually, the steam engine had quite a few problems, of course, where the farmers wanted to get it in the field. It was heavy, clumsy, didn't move around very well, and I have the impression that for making the gadget work, they actually burned straw. I can't quite visualize that, but I can guess that if you had a machine out in a field of ripe grain and you were trying to burn straw for your power, you'd have sparks and you'd have a terrific danger of fire. Furthermore, it sounds like a heavy machine and one that would take quite a bit of manpower. It sounds like it'd take two or three men probably at least to operate that type of equipment. So as the development came along and there was this possibility eventually that the petroleum products could be used. So Mr. Froelich in his blacksmith shop, with parts and pieces of probably stationary equipment, combining, he had an assistant, I think a man by the name of Mr. Mann, who worked with him. Finally, they got together this invention that Mr. Haig will show you after a while, and the day came, and I think it was 1892, that they wanted to try it. And one of the big victories in this, the contraption actually moved forward, and it moved backward, and then, as I said earlier, it went down the road. The very next year, Mr. Froelich moved on to Waterloo and started, and this is a fancy name for a factory, the I think it was called the Farm Traction, and I don't have the rest of the name offhand, but the point was they were going to try to make them. It was heartbreaking, though. They made two tractors. I don't know that they were calling it that, a traction engine, I think. Farmers tried them, returned both of them. The next year, one. The other year one, but it was not until World War II, Mr. Hake, that they actually were starting to make tractors in Waterloo that were meeting farmers' needs.
World War II or World War I?
World War I.
Yes, World War I.
Yes, right.
Uh-huh. Well, I don't suppose John Froelich ever made a fortune off of this himself, did he?
Well, he actually even gave up, and when you can think you don't sell just one tractor a year or two and have it returned and do anything. So they actually made their money in Waterloo making stationary engines, and I think they were making automobiles. And I'm afraid Mr. Froelich was up in St. Paul by 1918 when finally the John Deere people bought it, and then they had a successful motor.
That happens to many inventors, doesn't it?
Right.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Plain. Now, as Dr. Plain told you, this shows John Froelich in his Sunday clothes. He has his beard trimmed here and his hair combed. And he looks like a banker there, almost. Nice white shirt and silk tie. Now, let me show you a picture of John Froelich in his working clothes. Mr. Burlingame, who runs this store back here, very kindly let me use some old negatives that he had in the store so that I could print some pictures and show you some of the early days of John Froelich. This man here with the heavy bush is John Froelich. And it shows him with his threshing crew up in South Dakota. He owned this threshing rig. And every summer, he would get these men together from the Froelich neighborhood, and they would go up to South Dakota where they grew a lot of wheat, and he would thresh wheat for the farmers up there, and these men all made a pretty good thing out of that. But, as Dr. Plain also told you, the old threshing rigs were operated by these steam engines, and the fuel was straw, and the sparks coming out of this chimney here would often be blown over to the new straw, or would hit this stubble here in the field and set it afire. They tried to avoid that as much as possible by having this long shaft running from the engine all the way over here to the separator. They didn't dare use a belt because that put the engine too close to the separator with the straw flying through the air. And this was very, very cumbersome. So, in 1892, John Froelich said, there must be a better way to do this. And so he invented the first tractor, a gasoline traction engine. And here is a picture of the first tractor ever built. John Froelich mounted this one-cylinder, vertical stroke, gasoline traction engine on the rig for an old steam threshing machine. And this is a far cry from our modern tractor, but the important thing is that it worked. On this early summer day in 1892, John Froelich and his helper, William Mann, wheeled this out of the blacksmith shop, had it all put together, and a curious crowd stood around and watched this rather skeptically. And John Froelich tried to get the motor started, tried to get the engine started by pulling on this flywheel, and it just wouldn't budge. And somebody in the crowd said, well, I knew that was a fool contraption. I knew John would never be able to make it work. So William Mann got an idea. He got himself a .22 rifle cartridge and pried the bullet off of it so that it amounted to just a blank, you see. And then he put this blank cartridge up here in the priming cup and hit it with a hammer. And the thing went kerpow! And immediately it started the motor. The engine went round. Had to start it with a cartridge. But the important thing is that it worked. Once it got started, the wheel went around very merrily. And John Froelich got up here on the driving platform and threw it in gear, and the thing, with many a clank and a roar, moved slowly forward. Froelich stopped it, put it into another gear, and went slowly backwards. And so he proved that he had invented a traction engine. The word traction means that the engine would move, that it could be propelled forward and back. And this same man who had said, old John can never make that contraption work, said, I knew old John could do it. That's the way the public is. some part of the public anyhow. So here is the first tractor. Here is a view of the working parts of the tractor. This is all open, you see, and when he took this new gasoline traction engine up to South Dakota that summer of 1892, they had to stop it quite often and get the chaff and the straw out of these gears and cogs. Nowadays, that's all covered up, of course, and these parts move in oil, but not in the early days. Here's a picture of the first tractor in the wheat fields in South Dakota. Then there came the time when the John Deere Tractor Company and the friends of John Froelich decided that some sort of a memorial marker should be erected here in Froelich to commemorate this invention of the tractor. And here is the marker. With the stairs going up to it, a lamp post on either side, and on top of the marker there is this bronze plaque which says, "In this village, John Froelich built the first gasoline tractor that propelled itself backward as well as forward, far-reaching in its effect on modern agricultural history. It moved out of this village and into the world in 1892. Later that year, Mr. Froelich joined with others in organizing the Waterloo Gasoline Traction Engine Company, which later became the John Deere Tractor Company. And I'm sure you boys and girls know what a tractor looks like nowadays, but I thought it might be interesting to you to see a model of a modern tractor. And Mr. Lyle Cherry, the sales manager of the John Deere Tractor Company, gave me this scale model of a modern tractor. Isn't that a beauty? See, this is a scale model which actually turns the front wheels when you move the steering wheel. Back here is the plow with a lever to raise the plow, just as you can with a life-size model. In case the farmer drives across a gully or a ditch, you can raise this plow and avoid dulling the edges of the discs on the rocks. But that is the modern tractor, a far cry from the early primitive tractor designed by John Froelich. Dr. Plain, when did the word tractor itself come into use? John Froelich called his machine the gasoline traction engine.
I think we need to go to Charles City for that story. Mm-hmm. And there are two other very important names in the development of farm machinery appear. A gentleman by the name of Hart and another one by the name of Parr. And that immediately sounds like the development, the beginning of the Oliver plant at Charles City.
Yeah.
But what happened, these two gentlemen also working, seeing the importance of this type of power on the farm, worked out, and they had a machine that was operating in, I think it was 1898. Mm-hmm. And they started manufacturing it in Madison, Wisconsin, shortly moved it back to Charles City, I think. Mm-hmm. So they also were in business, and that one was called a tractor.
And I suppose the word is a sort of a combination of the two words, traction and motor.
Yes, that's tractor. Right. That's
tractor.
Right. And we forget that now as we take it for granted, I think.
It's a very common word. Mm-hmm. Well, did the tractor really have a tremendous influence upon Iowa farming, do you suppose? I mean, it eventually replaced the horse.
Well, I'm sort of glad I'm old enough to remember that one of the early effects it had, beyond the sheer changes, was that it gave one generation of farmers a lot to talk about. And I well remember when my father and his friends wondered who in the world or what was a farmer going to do with his oat crop if they ever gave up the horse. Another one, my father was rather convinced that this big heavy motor was going to pack that ground and they never would raise any good crops if they went back and forth with this heavy lumbering. Mm-hmm. Well, it was only 10 years later and he was one of the most enthusiastic owners that you could hope to find. And I would think, as nearly as I know, by the 1930s, the tractor had pretty well, and that means now that, well, I don't know, I guess it's been about 20 years since I've seen a horse in our horse barn.
Mm-hmm.
That's only one effect beyond the change in crops, of course, but you can see the other real things that it did. It lessened the cost of producing the grain, and it made necessary less farm labor. It permitted the enlargement of farms. And as far as our cities go, one of the important things, these tractor industries actually are the largest single employers in the state of Iowa in our towns.
Is that so?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And of course it has made it possible for the farmer to put in a longer day. He can even drive the tractor at night now.
That's right. The boys and girls, I'm sure, more than once gone down the road at night, and here's been a light going back and forth on Miss Farmer Brown's South 40, and they're aware that in the rush of the season, why they can, if they want to stay on the tractor, they can work around the clock.
So John Froelich undoubtedly made a great contribution to the development of farming and industry in Iowa.
But I think it's one part of the whole story of the history of invention.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Plain. All right, now, let's be sure we remember John Froelich in connection with the tractor. All of us know what a tractor is now. We recognize its importance on the farm, but very few people know that this man, John Froelich, who lived in this little village of Froelich, Iowa, in northeast Iowa, is the man who invented it, who had the vision and the imagination to develop something which had never been used before, something which simplified the whole process of threshing in the first place, and then something which could be used for other farm work. So let's see if we can get some kind of an impression of John Froelich here. This is not going to be a portrait of John Froelich, but we'll say these are the eyes with which John Froelich was able to see the need for improving things on the farm. I'll just indicate a little bit of his beard here. This is a kind of a combination of his Sunday beard and his threshing beard. I showed you the two extremes a while ago. Now, the important thing to remember about John Froelich is that he saw the world about him and the needs of the farmer not with only his two physical eyes, but with another eye in his head, the eye of the imagination. And this is the thing which inventors have that most of us do not have. All of us have this eye of the imagination, but very seldom do we use it. Very seldom do we bother to open this eye, this third eye, inside the head. But inventors have it open all the time, and John Froelich was an inventor, a creative genius, who saw an opportunity for making a gasoline engine, a stationary engine, move a threshing rig. And so, because of this third eye, he was able to develop something which had never been used before, a vertical one-cylinder engine had the tank way up here like that, and the flywheel in here. And so we have the first tractor. And even though we have lost sight of Froelich himself, the tractor is a kind of a monument to his creative genius. Next week, we are going to visit another landmark which is connected with Iowa industry in Cedar Rapids, and I'll let you guess what industry that is. I hope you'll be with me next week in Cedar Rapids to see some of the landmarks there. Until then, goodbye.
Today, your teachers have been Herb Hake and Irma Plain of Iowa State Teachers College. Landmarks in Iowa History is produced for Iowa TV Schooltime by WOI-TV in association with Iowa State Teachers College. TV Schooltime is presented by the Iowa Joint Committee for Educational Television.